Anybody who's been watching my channel for a while knows that I have taken it upon myself to bitch about the games and practices of Digital Homicide, aka the two-person game development studio run by brothers James and Robert Romine, in a vain attempt to siphon some views and subscribers off their notoriety as some of the worst people on the indie gaming circuit. I've covered the bulk of the games in their library, all shit. I've got 4 or 5 more games of theirs in reserve that I can still cover on a rainy day with nothing to do, and I've tried in my incredibly small capacity to be a little signal boost for their underhanded tactics and business practices, but between Digital Homicide suing 100 people and getting kicked off Steam, there's been a lot of news about them recently. News that I've been holding off covering because I wanted to wait for the dust to settle before talking about it, and because I've been focusing on reviewing Duke Nukem Forever. Just for my own benefit, I began mapping out the long list of transgressions and bile Digital Homicide has been responsible for, and now that their story has more or less come to an end, I've decided to turn that list into a script, and that script into a video. So this video is a full recap, to the best of my knowledge, of Digital Homicide's brief career on Steam, a look back at the full tapestry that is their monumental failure. Feel free to fill in any details that I'm missing in the comments. This is the full extent of what I know and was able to learn about them, and just an FYI, this video's footage is nothing but just me playing some Digital Homicide games with no context, because screw it, they're not worth the effort. Digital Homicide's career began around August to September 2014, when they published an extremely half-baked and incomplete MMO called Forsaken Uprising, and an outright horrendous shooter called The Slaughtering Grounds on Steam. Jim Sterling, a games journalist who rolls around Steam playing any 2-bit indie game he can find for first impressions videos, played The Slaughtering Grounds and made a 10-minute video in which he basically fumbled around trying to figure out how the hell the game works because it's so horrendously designed. The day after Sterling's Slaughtering Grounds video went up, Digital Homicide reposted said video with text laid over it where they bitched about how Sterling was reviewing the game despite not understanding thing one about how it worked, repeatedly called him a fucking idiot, coined the term "I'm Jim fucking Sterling, son," and complained that he should have used developer forums to report bugs and flaws rather than tell the public about them in a review. So not only did they completely miss the point that Sterling's video was not a review but a first impressions let's play, they also seemed to think that reviews should only ever be positive, and any complaints should only be sent to the developer instead of letting the public know about them. Kinda ironic when you consider all of their games had litanies of bugs and design problems that went completely unpatched, almost like they ignore criticism anyway, but that's skipping ahead a little bit. The back and forth continued, with Sterling reposting their video laughing about the sheer ludicrousness of it all, and Digital Homicide reposting his repost bitching about how internet critics are leeches, until they just flat out issued a copyright takedown on Sterling's video. Digital Homicide claims that Sterling violated fair use copyright law with his video because his video was not fair, demonstrating a complete lack of understanding of how law works. They vowed to take Sterling to court, Sterling called their bluff by filing a counterclaim, Digital Homicide took no action, and the video went back up. I just think it's worth remembering that the very first time somebody criticized them, Digital Homicide's first reaction was to harass them, and their second reaction was to threaten legal action. This turned out not to be a one-time mistake from an amateur developer, but the first instance of a recurring pattern of a developer lashing out at anybody who crossed them and refusing to accept criticism of their products. After cranking out several Steam Greenlight games, all of which Jim Sterling mocked because he does that too, Digital Homicide returned with Temper Tantrum, Deadly Prophets, and Medieval Mercs, each game worse than the last, each game with barely any actual original programming, and each built entirely out of pre-made assets that you can purchase from the Unity storefront. In addition to covering each of these games, Jim Sterling did an episode of his journalism show The Jimquisition, where he called out Digital Homicide and other low-effort developers for doing what he termed asset flipping, i.e. building a game entirely out of pre-made levels and models and barely putting any actual original work into said game. It's honestly astounding how far Digital Homicide goes to deny engaging in this practice, despite the Slaughtering Grounds zombies appearing in other games from other studios, most of their medieval-themed games recycling enemies heavily, and the character models and environments from Temper Tantrum being piss easy to find unmodified on the Unity store. Freshly pissed off that Sterling's renewed coverage at them, Digital Homicide invited Jim to an interview to be recorded and posted on the internet. I confess I have not listened to the interview myself because there are few things on this earth that piss me off more than listening to a complete idiot talk authoritatively about topics he clearly knows jack shit about. But here's the highlights. Robert Romine spent the entire interview angrily shouting at Jim, trying to dox him and tie him to another journalist who shares his last name, lobbying false accusation against Jim, trying desperately to catch Jim in some kind of scandal or gaffe, asking loaded questions, cutting Jim off before he could answer questions, and abruptly abruptly changing the subject whenever Jim asked a question about his company that he didn't want to answer. Jim walked away from the interview relatively unscathed, while Digital Homicide walked away looking like a petulant whiny man-children. Shortly after the interview, some anti-Sterling Tumblr pages showed up again trying to pin a fake scandal on Sterling using flimsy fake evidence. I don't know whether these pages were ever definitively linked to Digital Homicide, but they shared enough aspects with the Digital Homicide style that it's a very plausible open question. For a while after the disastrous interview, Digital Homicide appeared to go dormant, seemingly doing nothing more heinous than taking down and re-uploading the same game to Greenlight multiple times to reset each game's negative votes, something that a ton of hack developers are guilty of. Temper Tantrum 2 was posted onto Greenlight for approval to get onto Steam something like 5 times to continually reset the game's negative votes. Temper Tantrum 2, by the way, is the exact same game as Temper Tantrum 1, only now the levels are city-themed instead of eye-bleaching bright rooms we found pre-made themed. But it soon turned out that Digital Homicide had in fact been very busy this whole time. It just took a while for their latest scheme to unravel. Jim came across two innocuous Steam games called Devil's Share and Galactic Hitman, both of which were riddled with bugs and appeared to be half-finished, especially Galactic Hitman, once it was discovered enemies couldn't shoot you if you ducked. These games were produced by ECC Games. And after Jim covered them, he got an email from a Polish company called ECC Games, who claimed they had nothing to do with Devil Share or Galactic Hitman, and they were none too pleased that some joker was putting their name on these shit pile games. After one of the games was mistakenly listed as a Digital Homicide title and included in a Digital Homicide bundle, it was revealed that not only had Digital Homicide posted Devil Share and Galactic Hitman under a fake account, but they had also posted 9 new games to Steam Greenlight under 7 or 8 other different fake accounts. Around this time, they were also linked to a website called BundleBlitz.com that was trying to give away keys for free Steam games in exchange for Greenlight votes on Digital Homicide titles and other indie games. Once the story unraveled, BundleBlitz.com was transformed into Digital Homicide's official homepage. Now, none of this is against any rules on Steam other than the fact that one of their shell accounts accidentally used the name of a real-life company, and it's understandable that Digital Homicide would want to escape their deserved bad reputation, but Steam users do not take kindly to being ripped off, and given how unprecedentedly horrible their games were, trying to slip them onto Steam unnoticed did not sit well with anybody in the user base. Jim Sterling naturally blew the story wide open, the company became an even greater laughingstock than it already was, and Digital Homicide grew enraged. As Jim's coverage of Digital Homicide ramped up, James Romine gave Jim a phone call. Jim had written an article on his website, thejimquisition.com, where he accused Digital Homicide of stealing a game's cover art from DeviantArt when the image was actually purchased from Shutterstock. Jim found out and quickly corrected the article with an apology, but the Romines live in Arizona, where you can apparently still sue somebody for defamation over an article that's been corrected. Sensing an opening to hit Sterling where it hurts, James told Sterling that they had acquired a lawyer and were preparing to sue Jim for defamation. He said they'd submit the papers unless Jim signed a contract swearing that he would never discuss Digital Homicide or their games ever again. When Jim replied that he would need to speak with his legal team before making a decision, Romine became enraged, shouted that a decision had been made, and immediately hung up. Jim was assured by his lawyers that he had nothing to worry about, and in a show of hubris he probably came to regret, posted a few more videos poking fun at Digital Homicide. This prompted James and Robert Romine to sack up and officially file a lawsuit against Jim Sterling, seeking $10.7 million in damages, the total of which was later bumped up to $15 million. The charges listed are defamation, as they believe everything Sterling's ever said about them has been lies designed specifically to cripple their business, loss of income, as they believe it's exclusively Sterling's fault that their games stopped selling well, and mental anguish, as some of Sterling's more dickish fans have vigorously harassed Digital Homicide and even sent threatening letters and boxes of feces to their houses. Keep in mind, Jim has repeatedly and publicly pleaded for his followers not to harass anybody. They essentially blamed their struggling business and horrible reputation on one solitary person, never mind the fact that even when they used fake accounts to sell games that were completely unconnected to Digital Homicide or Jim Sterling, they were still widely panned, which any rational person would take to mean that they just suck at their jobs. But, yeah, that's just how logic works. Sterling hasn't said much about the case for fear of digging himself a bigger hole, so facts about the case are scarce. We do know that the case has been going on for about 6 months by this point, with no significant developments or actions from the Romines, and we know that Sterling filed to have the case dismissed, but his motion was denied. We can also infer that the Romines are representing themselves in this case, because they started a Kickstarter campaign to raise the funds to actually hire their lawyer, and out of the needed $75,000, they raised $435. Less than 1% of the goal. So yeah, the guys who threatened to sue Jim Sterling over a fair use violation because his criticisms weren't fair are representing themselves in court. I would almost pay to see that play out. Interestingly, some acquaintances of mine on Steam who are well-versed in legal matters said that most lawyers keep a nest egg that they can use for cases where their client can't pay them until the case is complete, and the fact that their lawyer apparently demanded to be paid before starting the case means that he probably knew the case was doomed from the outset. Now, all of this isn't to say that Digital Homicide didn't have a point. Yes, Jim Sterling's negative coverage undoubtedly cost them sales. Yes, Jim could have stopped talking about them at any time. But by the time this lawsuit was filed, Digital Homicide had not only been harassing Jim Sterling for months, but they had released 11 games on Steam, all of which had overwhelmingly bad reviews from the community. Not from Jim, not from Jim's fans, it was the consensus of the normal independent people who had played their games and deemed them to be crap. The only game they ever made that got positive reviews was Dungeons of Cragmore, an MMO whose players fled the game en masse due to rampant glitches that Digital Homicide outright refused to fix. And this is really a keen insight into how they treated their games and their customers. Even when Digital Homicide somehow managed to luck out and make a game that people liked, they couldn't be bothered to patch the problems that the game's fans complained about. They either didn't care about the game because it had already turned a profit and thus wasn't worth any more effort, their heads are large so far up their asses they didn't believe there were bugs in the first place, or they're so bad at actual programming that they didn't know how to fix the bugs even if they wanted to. With behavior and a catalog of this level of shittiness, there's not really anybody taking Digital Homicide's side on this non-issue. They were basically arguing that they should be allowed to continue making games and were entitled to having them sell well and be positively covered in spite of their products being consistent garbage. That they should be entitled to prosper at a job they continue to miserably suck at. The lawsuit against Jim Sterling was, by far, the most media coverage that Digital Homicide had gotten, and the sum effect that it had was to fill Steam and YouTube with legions of people who were determined to fill Jim's void and make sure these people didn't get away with making more crap. So with their reputation even worse and more widespread than ever before, their games began selling even worse. So with a lawsuit pending against Jim Sterling, no money with which to actually pursue the lawsuit, and their game selling worse than ever before, due to making gigantic bowel cancer-laden asses of themselves, Digital Homicide managed to dramatically increase the volume of games that they were producing. I did a review of every game Digital Homicide had released at the time, and that video went live on May 19th, 2016. At the time that video went up, Digital Homicide had 11 games on Steam and 24 additional completed games attempting to pass through Steam Greenlight. More games produced in under 2 years than multiple indie devs combined produced in their lifetimes. Within 2 weeks of that video going live, they had 5 new games on Steam and a plethora of new games on Steam Greenlight. One tactic that they used to crank up their production was they began reskinning some of their old titles and essentially reselling the same game under different names. In my Digital Homicide Library review, I covered a game of theirs called Krog Wars, a shitty Space Invaders clone with a glitch that often failed to load the next level, leaving you stuck on a blank screen. The game was literally unplayable. After Krog Wars got onto Steam, they released Wyatt Derp, which was the exact same game as Krog Wars only with the spaceships replaced with cowboys, Wyatt Derp 2, which was the exact same game as Wyatt Derp 1 only with the camera rotated a bit, and Withering Kingdoms Arcane War, which was the same game as Krog Wars and Wyatt Derp, only this time it was Wizards. All three of these games passed through Steam Greenlight because it's easy to make a Space Invaders clone look playable in a 30-second trailer, and so Digital Homicide began absolutely spamming Krog Wars clones onto Greenlight, feeling that they had struck a goldmine of easy revenue. Digital Homicide runs a page on the indie gaming site itch.io where you can purchase most of the games the studio has created, and if you go to their itch.io page, you will find 30. 3030 clones of Krog Wars that Digital Homicide attempted to sell on Steam as completely separate games. You'll find Krog Wars, 2 Wyatt Derps, 2 Withering Kingdoms, 3 Sinister Spiders, 5 Sarah to the Rescues, 3 Daisy Sweet Times, 3 Mike the Astronauts, 3 Barnacle Explorer Subs, 2 Pete's Pumpkin Apocalypses, 3 Merle Wizard Extraordinaires, a game called Not In My Crapper, formerly called Assholes, and 2 Assault on Zarter's games. All the same weapons, all the same levels, the same one game copied and pasted 30 times with different names and reskinned to look like different titles. This little scheme of theirs got so ludicrously out of hand that Valve had to actually step in and police its damn storefront for a change. Valve blacklisted 22 of Digital Homicide's games from Steam Greenlight, preventing them from releasing any of them by marking them incompatible with Greenlight. And even after Valve took this unprecedented action, they still snuck another Krog Wars clone onto Steam a few months later with Withering Kingdoms Arcane War. A petulant child who got caught with his hand in the cookie jar only to plunge his hand back in the second the adults weren't looking, and a scathing indictment of how utterly ineffective Valve is even when it decides to do something to clean up Steam. Some of the other games on their itch.io account are clones as well. Mini Attack Submarine and Hovering Hell of Death both appear to be clones of Starship Nova Strike, and Grimez's Journey appears to be a direct clone of Assault on Orion 7, despite neither of them even getting released. A fun little fact about their itch.io page, when you purchase one of the games on their itch.io account, you don't actually get a copy of the game. You get a key for the game that you can redeem on Steam, if the game gets greenlight and actually makes it onto the store. In other words, Digital Homicide was using its itch.io account to sell games that might well never have gotten released, probably in a desperate ploy to bribe people into greenlighting their games. I mean, who on God's earth would be stupid enough to buy a game before it's even released? Digital Homicide trucked on after that, basically by utilizing every broken exploit that exists on the Steam store. They got game after game through the Greenlight voting system by promising each game would have trading cards that users can sell for a profit. I was stunned to learn that when a Steam user sells the trading cards of a game, the creator of that game gets a kickback, so Digital Homicide gets paid every time somebody sells the cards they get for buying their games. This led to them discovering and abusing a trick that's becoming popular on Steam. Give a shit ton of the games away for free, and collect royalties off the sales of the trading cards from the people that you gave the games to. You give copies of the game away for free, the users you gave the game to sell the cards, and you get paid for giving away free copies. Essentially, you no longer even need a game to sell to make money off of it on Steam. And this is not an exploit that's unique to Digital Homicide. Anybody can do it. Digital Homicide continued on this way for a while, continuing to crank out games at a stunning rate, and if the near total lack of completed mechanics in the decimation of Valorath is any indication, actively somehow getting worse. This continued on until Operation Cleanlight happened. For those of you who have no idea what Greenlight is, it's Valve's half-assed response to customers demanding quality control on Steam. Games that are complete are posted with a trailer, screenshots, and a description to Greenlight, and users vote on whether the game goes onto Steam or not. Deserved or otherwise, Greenlight has become a notorious shithole of horrible games, with good games getting tragically buried under mountains of shit and completely overlooked. You've got users who upvote anything with trading cards, users who upvote things ironically saying, "Wouldn't it be funny if that was real?" See Grass Simulator for a prime example. Teenage and younger users who upvote anything with internet memes because 420 lols, I desperately want to be like the cool kids, and the rise of Steam groups like YOLO Army that actively bribe users with free Steam keys for other games in exchange for upvotes for any developers that do business with them. This has nothing to do with Digital Homicide, but it gives some important context to what would prove to be their downfall. Several large groups of Steam users decided that they'd had enough of Greenlight being a festering cesspool of shit, and decided that they were going to start doing their part to clean up Greenlight and prevent these awful games from getting onto Steam. These groups, which I like to call the Greenlight Crusaders, essentially gather together and encourage people to actually go through Greenlight, downvote the shit that shouldn't be on Steam, and upvote the good games that struggle for relevance. I myself am a member of a group called Digital Homicide's Poop Gaming. They essentially act as get-out-the-vote campaigns, encouraging users to actually participate in Greenlight and do their part to keep games they actually want on Steam. In other words, they don't do anything that's even remotely suspicious, amoral, or against any rules. They're just participating in the Steam community in an active manner. It didn't take Digital Homicide long to realize these Greenlight Crusaders were cutting into their profits by stopping their games getting onto the storefront through legitimate votes, and they didn't like that. Not one bit. Did that Joker voice carry through or not? Anyway, the leading members of Digital Homicide's Poop Gaming published an announcement that Digital Homicide had directly contacted the most prolific members of multiple Greenlight Crusader groups. They said, in no uncertain terms, that they were drawing up new legal papers and that if we didn't lay off their games on Greenlight, we were going to get served. And these messages were sent several weeks before the lawsuits actually went through. These Greenlight groups were undeterred, since they hadn't done jack against Jim Sterling for months, and continued negatively reviewing Digital Homicide's games and voting against them on Greenlight. So, in September 2016, Digital Homicide filed a personal injury lawsuit against 100 Steam users. 11 of the defendants were named, and the other 89 spots were intentionally left empty with John Doe's to be named later. The suit was for a grand total of $18 million. The damages were listed as emotional distress, financial distress, public humiliation caused by harassment, stalking, cyberbullying, conspiracy to commit civil rights violations, formation of hate groups, and the part that really just makes me facepalm, continual criminal property damage for over a year. Digital Homicide is attempting to sue 100 people who talked smack about them in comment threads and reviewed their games poorly by claiming that the Greenlight Crusaders are hate groups and that negative reviews are defamation lies and constitute criminal destruction of property. The sick thing is that an article in an Arizona paper reveals that before turning to a lawsuit, Digital Homicide attempted to turn to local law enforcement and even tried to enlist the FBI to shut down the people they said were harassing them. Digital Homicide tried to bring down the full wrath of United States law enforcement to stop people from talking about video games. Digital Homicide claims up and down that the purpose of the lawsuit is to stop harassment that has been directed against them, people posting crude and threatening comments such as "go die in a fire" and "your wife is a whore." It is indefensible that people do, in fact, post such crude, hateful messages online, and such attacks are never justified, even against somebody as vile as Digital Homicide. But once you actually sift through the court papers that Digital Homicide submitted, their true motivations become crystal clear. Pretty much every piece of evidence that they included in their own lawsuit is a screenshot of either a negative review or a member of the Greenlight Crusaders raising awareness of their underhanded and cheap tactics and policies in comment sections. Shit that's well documented and verifiable, by the way. They're still taking offense when people accuse them of asset flipping despite being piss easy to research and confirm. Actions speak louder than words, and though they claim they're suing over the harassment, the actual evidence included in the suit makes it clear they're suing over the negative reviews and people raising awareness about their underhanded activities. Digital Homicide may construe the negative reviews as harassment, but they are, in actuality, trying to sue people for reviewing their games poorly, something that is protected by the right to free speech. The lawsuit also dictates that if a defendant is unable to pay or lives outside the United States and thus can't be sued, then they demand said defendant's Steam account be permanently closed and they lose all their games and purchases as recompense. A lot of people are pointing to this little detail and speculating that the claims of destruction of property are bullshit, and they're just out for simple revenge with this whole scheme. Me personally, I don't think the two are mutually exclusive. It's difficult to gauge exactly how crazy a crazy person is. Let's be serious for a minute here. Can you imagine the kind of horrifying precedent this case would set if it went forward and they won? If Digital Homicide can sue people for leaving negative reviews, what's to stop 20th Century Fox from suing every review outlet that slammed Fant4Stick and lost them millions of dollars in ticket sales? What's to stop Deep Silver from suing everybody who negatively reviewed Ride to Hell Retribution, demolishing an IP in their entire new franchise before they even got off the ground? This lawsuit, if successful, would effectively destroy consumer awareness, as media would be forced to sing the praises of anything and everything or risk being sued. Believe it or not, it actually gets better. See, YouTube user Lord Crocosquirrel made a video called Review the Developer, Digital Homicide 7, where he and some other YouTubers took a very detailed look at Digital Homicide's lawsuit against the 100. The lawsuit is so poorly written that the remaining 89 defendants could encompass anybody who does, ever has, or ever will work in the games industry or profit off video games, including YouTube content creators, and also encompasses the entirety of Steam's user base. Wow! I mean, just wow! Luckily, we're being spared that shitstorm spectacle because this story, it turns out, has a happy ending. See, you can't actually sue somebody unless you have their names to issue subpoenas, so Digital Homicide was granted a subpoena to Valve for the personal information of the 11 named people in their lawsuit. I don't know how true this is, but I've read on TV Tropes that the lawsuit sneaks enough information that Digital Homicide could track these people down and kill them if they so desired. Valve responded to the subpoena by kicking Digital Homicide the fuck off of Steam, closing their account, purging all of their games and Greenlight titles from the service. None of them can be purchased anymore. They were wiped clean off the store. No more Digital Homicide games, no more harassing comments, no more Digital Homicide, period. When asked for comment, Doug Lombardi, Valve's VP of marketing, simply said to the press, "Valve has stopped doing business with Digital Homicide for being hostile to Steam users." It's safe to say that Digital Homicide did not take this development well, as a long, angry rant soon appeared on their homepage, threatening to sue Valve for an exhaustive list of alleged breaches of contract. The long and short of it is that Digital Homicide thinks Valve betrayed them by letting the people who are posting bad reviews and mean comments go unpunished, but then kicking them off Steam when they tried to defend themselves, completely failing to understand that there's a big gap between leaving a mean comment about someone and suing a person for more money than they will ever see in their lives. Valve, being a massively rich company with an army of lawyers staring down two dumbasses, seemingly completely ignored these ramblings and didn't respond. On September 27, 2016, Digital Homicide officially filed to dismiss the lawsuit against the 100, which the judge granted without prejudice, meaning that Digital Homicide can file the lawsuit later without running into double jeopardy. In the papers issuing the request, they cite that the damages inflicted to them by Valve and the Steam users have left them too broke to actually afford sending out any of the paperwork required to pursue the lawsuit. Members of the Greenlight Crusaders are suspicious of that story, and the more legally versed among them speculate that the judge was unwilling to give the Romines the direct personal information of the people they're intending to victimize, since they didn't have a lawyer to act as a buffer for them. But whatever, the official story is they can't afford the lawsuit anymore. In the follow-up interview with TechRaptor, they also declared that Digital Homicide Gaming Studios is officially closed and out of business, and as one final dig at the industry they miserably failed in, they declared that they were re-entering the workforce, as if to imply that game development isn't a real job. They also went off on a completely nonsensical rant that they believe most of the harassment was done at the behest of some mysterious unknown competitor on Steam's indie scene who wanted to drive them out of business and steal their customers, because they can't really blame Jim Sterling for their problems anymore, and God forbid, people just don't like their games very much. Even now, at the end of the line, with all cards laid on the table, they refuse to even consider the motion that maybe, just maybe, they were bad at their jobs or people didn't like their games because their games were crap. No, everything has to be a conspiracy, specifically targeting them and wanting them out of the way for some mysterious unknown reason. No, everything is a conspiracy. Everybody wants these two random yahoos out of business for sinister purposes. We've done nothing wrong, and all these people are harassing us for no reason. Unbelievable. It's because of this deeply delusional behavior that I doubt we've seen or heard the last of Digital Homicide. Plus, despite occasional rumors that they were filing to dismiss the case as well, the lawsuit against Jim Sterling is still ongoing. But for now, they're out of business and can't hurt anybody anymore. So that was the long and stupefying tale of Digital Homicide, a developer who lashed out at anybody who criticized their work, threatened and then sued anybody who crossed them, repeatedly participating in some of the most vile anti-consumer behavior I've ever seen from a video game developer, and played the victim throughout the entire ordeal. Myself, I think they might have genuine mental problems, or at the very least, some form of egomania. You can't spout shit this crazy for this long and constantly preach that somebody is out to get you and everybody doesn't like you is in on it without having a few genuine bats in the belfry. But let's not lose sight of what this whole ordeal was about. A developer made a lot of shitty games they clearly put zero effort into and tried to silence the critics who called them out on their bullshit through threats and legal action, ratcheting up their vile and self-destructive behavior until they were consumed by their own flames. The only good to come out of this whole mess is a giant red warning sign to other indie developers. If you make a bad game and get bad reviews, either fix it or suck it up and move on. You are one, the people are many, and the will of the people always wins out. You are not entitled to success in any line of work, and game development is no different. So don't try to silence critics. Don't try to scam people or come up with ways to game the system. If you want to be successful in this life, you have to work for it. Digital Homicide, goodbye and good riddance.